My Life and Ethiopia's Progress, Concerning Universal Church Code, Rastafari Order of Business, page 176. We and the Empress, our family, and princes and nobles went to the church at midnight. It had been arranged that our foreign guests should only arrive at 7 o'clock in the morning, and they then took their seats, which had been prepared on the right and on the left of the throne, according to their rank. The seating order provided that Ethiopian princes and nobles should be interspread among the foreign guests. Before the royal ritual began, the Archbishop Abuna Kyrios approached with a gospel bound in gold and asked us to complete the following words of the oath. 1. That we should strengthen the Orthodox faith which had remained steadfast in Ethiopia from the days of the holy kings Abreha and Abisha, and that we should keep without disturbance the laws and ordinances which the Orthodox Church had laid down. 2. That in all we are doing by our authority and our power to the people in the imperial realm of Ethiopia, we should act with consideration for the interest of the people according to law, as well as with kindness and with patience. 3. That we would permanently maintain the laws we had established after submitting them of our own free will to the council for advice, and that we would safeguard the entire Ethiopian realm and people in accordance with established law and the ordinances of the council. 4. That we would assist by our goodwill and authority the establishment of schools at which secular and spiritual education would be developed in Ethiopia and in which the Gospels would be preached. After we had completed the swearing-in ceremony, affirming our willingness to maintain all that is laid down above, we appended our signature thereto. Subsequently, the Archbishop assigned to the six bishops their respective functions in the coronation service, and then prayers were begun. Of these bishops, 5 were Ethiopians. The 6th was Abuna Yosab, who had come from Egypt as the envoy of the Patriarch of Alexandria, Abuna Yohannes, to partake in the joy of our coronation and to convey his blessing. After the Archbishop and bishops had completed the service performing readings and prayers, with the choir singing, the Archbishop approached and anointed us with the oil of kingship and placed the imperial crown on us. At this moment, our heir to the throne, His Highness Asfawasin, removed the coronet from his head, and when he knelt before us, the Archbishop approached with a gospel and asked him to take the following oath. 1. That he would honor his father with his whole heart and be obedient to him. 2. That he would not seek in association with evil men what we had not given him of our own will. 3. That he would keep the laws which we had established after referring them of our own free will to the council for advice. After he had sworn to fulfill this, he appended his signature to it. Subsequently, the coronation service of the empress commenced. The procedure for the enthronement of the empress is today very different from what is used to be previously. According to our historical study of earlier practice, the empress was not anointed with the oil of kingship on the grounds that she did not share in rulership with the emperor. The crown, being merely symbolic, was very small. It was in the palace that the emperor placed the crown on her head and not in the church. This occurred on the third day, for it was not permitted for her to be crowned on the same day as the emperor, but now it was determined after consultation and was accordingly carried out that except for the regal anointing, the archbishop should place the crown on her and put the diamond ring on her finger, and that this should be on the same day jointly with the coronation of the emperor. Chapter 29. About our setting up a constitution. In former times, when kings ruled the people according to their own will, be it in Europe, Asia, or Africa, there used to be a good deal of upheaval and divergence between the kings and the people, as well as members of the royal family. The history of the governance of many countries demonstrates this. In our country, in Ethiopia, it is used to be done likewise. We had therefore been contemplating the promulgation of a constitution for our reign, to bequeath to our heirs a form of rule that is based on law, and to bring our people into partnership in the work of government. In fact, while we were still crown prince and regent plenipotentiary of the Ethiopian realm, we had told Queen Sauditu that it would be of great benefit to government and the people if a constitution were established. But some of the great nobles, to whose advantage it was to rule the country without a constitution, had pretended that it would diminish the dignity and authority of Queen Sauditu if a constitution were set up. For this reason, our plan had remained unfulfilled. At that time, although we were regent plenipotentiary, there were complex circumstances involved. Before tackling any major affairs, I used to inform Her Majesty Empress Sauditu. If she accepted the matter, I arranged for it to be carried out at once. Yet if she did not approve, I did not wish to upset her and do things by force. Instead, insisting that I was regent plenipotentiary, but rather to convince her by repeatedly reverting to the matter. This arose from the consideration that it was necessary to be careful lest disturbances or bloodshed should occur in the country. Hence I patiently delayed the establishment of a constitution. But after the death of Queen Sauditu on 25th Magabit, 1922, 2nd of April, 1930, we inherited crown and throne by due process of law, and therefore decided to set up the constitution we had planned earlier on during our regency. Hence we examined the constitutions of various countries and chose people who possessed experience and knowledge of foreign countries, as well as those versed in the customs and early history of each province inside the country, and commanded them to select and extract from the constitutions of foreign countries what was appropriate for the Ethiopian people, and then to submit recommendations to us. When these had been set down in writing and had been presented, we examined them, and then gave orders to the following persons to make a joint study and to submit them prepared for signature. From among the nobles, Raskasu Hailu Tekle Haimanot, Rasiyum Mengesha, Rasguksa Araya, Rasemru Haile Shelase. From among ministers, the Minister of War, Fetaurari Beru Walde Gebria, the Minister of Interior, Fetwadet Walde Tzadik Goshu, the Foreign Minister, Platangueta Heroi Walde Selase, the Minister of the Pen, Tzhafe Te'ezas Walde Meskel Tariku. From among officials, Dejismach Yegazu Behabte, Bajeron Tekle Hawariat. These men, who had been instructed to investigate the matter and then to present it ready for signature, had remained disunited in their views and had therefore spent a great deal of time arguing in our presence. Ras Emru alone among the nobles had shared the opinion of the ministers and officials, while the remaining four nobles were united among themselves in a rather different view. The opinion of the nobles was that Ethiopia, having been divided into various large provinces, each should be given as hereditary property to the nobles, passing on from generation to generation, that their descendants should not be disinherited unless it were proved against them that they had committed some serious criminal act against the emperor or the government, that the provincial landowners within their domain, having the region they hold recognized as their hereditary property, should continue to pay taxes to the nobles and remain subservient to them. In general, this connotes a feudal form of government. But the opinion of the ministers and officials was as follows. If Ethiopia, divided into its respective large provinces, were given as hereditary property to the nobles and landowners, passing on from generation to generation, and if it were claimed that appointments were limited to their descendants, how was there to be a rising generation in the future? If a man has studied and given service and yet does not obtain office or an administrative appointment, How can he say Ethiopia is my country? Therefore, let the present nobles and landowners, unless some wrongdoing is proved against them, stay on in their office of governor only. But if they are dismissed for some misdemeanor or die, then let any Ethiopian who possesses the knowledge and ability be appointed to their governorship, for exclusive succession within the family is not a proper procedure. But if their sons are found to be like other men in knowledge and in service, then let the emperor in his wisdom appoint them to their father's governorship or other post of rank. Yet it does not appear to us proper for it to be laid down in the constitution that their governorship should pass from father to son as hereditary property. When the nobles saw that the ministers and officials did not accept the opinion they had submitted, they put forward as an alternative the following plan under which it would be laid down in the constitution that some districts only, out of many within their governorships, would pass on as hereditary. But the ministers and officials refused to accept this view and remained steadfast in their earlier opinion. When we heard that the men whom we had selected for this task remained divided in their opinions, we arranged that both sides should submit their proposals, together with supporting evidence in writing. After we had examined the matter, we decided as follows. The emperor may assign hereditary land rights and land held as a fief, either to nobles or to other servants of the realm. A paragraph to this effect is to be written into the constitution, and in future things are to be arranged as required, having regard to their services. But so we explained to the nobles, it was no longer proper that, since we were aware that feudal rule had ceased in the world, we should now once again reaffirm it, either having it laid down in the constitution or governing without a constitution. Once matters had been clarified, they were to be written down and prepared for signature. After we arranged for nobles and ministers, army commanders and provincial governors, chiefs, bishops, and savants, for all to assemble at an important ceremony, then the constitution which had been prepared for signature was read out to them, and all affirmed their view with one voice. We like it. Let it be set up. Nevertheless, in Ethiopia, for some 3,000 years since the days of Menelik I, the customary method of rule was not a king who governed by a constitution, having set up a parliament, but an emperor who governed by his own authority alone. Some men who were our particular friends did not understand the matter, and therefore they advised me with sincerity as follows. How can you, by your own action, hand over to the people your authority of government? Please cause this to be stopped. When I explained things to them to the best of my ability, they accepted the argument. When the ninth day of Hamle, 1923, 16th July 1931, was fixed as the date for the signing of the Constitution and the promulgation of the decree, we gave orders to our Minister of the PIN to inform the senior officials and to our foreign minister to notify the foreign diplomats. The foreign diplomats arrived with great prompt at 4 o'clock, 10 a.m., on the appointed date and stood by their seats according to their rank. We then made the following speech explaining the reason why we had thought it right to establish a constitution. We were thinking that it was not enough for us to thank our Lord with words alone for the trust we had received from God to guard Ethiopia and for granting us this high rank of emperor, nor was it sufficient to appease him with minor deeds and with what was of benefit to ourselves only. Although we were striving to set up a constitution that was of benefit extending to everybody, enduring forever and being transmitted from generation to generation, this was still not enough to repay the Lord's favor, because we wished to reveal to you our intention of entrusting to God the fulfillment of the task we had begun. We have assembled you here at this hour in a great gathering. Nobody will fail to appreciate that law is the greatest benefit to every man. It is from the equity of law that honor and advantage arise. It is from the deficiency of law that distress and damage result. It is through failure to set up law that violence and injury grow. While God, being above every creature, would not find it difficult to issue orders by his word alone, yet his instituting law is because he knew that law should be the supreme ruler of the whole world. He who merits being called just among men is whatever in whatever sphere it might be, is the person who strives and devours by the knowledge given to him to benefit the majority, even though not all mankind as a whole, when pursuing his principal aim, although for a number of reasons our plan had been delayed in its execution, our entire endeavor, which we had initiated a long time ago, had been to set up a framework of law for the state. Therefore, our idea, which we pursued steadfastly, and which we formulated for Ethiopia and our beloved people, is to declare to you now, first, our granting a constitution to the Ethiopian people, and secondly, our wish to follow this law meticulously and to maintain it. In this constitution, which we are giving to the Ethiopian people, the principal ideas formulated in it are the following. 1. It is to bring about that Ethiopia, being one family undivided by sections, the people shall live in unity, controlled by one law and governed by one emperor, and that this power of unity shall be safeguarded by the interest which bind them permanently together, and, while the interest of the individual shall not be abandoned, the strength of the united community shall be paramount, without sacrificing the benefits due to individuals or oneself. One is not to seek divisive private interest. 2. The law, in its function of conferring advantage or punishment, shall be equitable without showing favor to whomever it may be. 3. By virtue of the fact that in times past the people of Ethiopia remained cut off from the countries and were therefore unable to secure the advantages which the great civilizations of today confer, as well as by virtue of adhering to their own age-old civilization, the kings of Ethiopia, being like good fathers to the people, continued carrying on their work of administration. But now, since our people have progressively advanced in whatever sphere to a higher level of civilization, time has permitted us to establish a constitution and to bring the people into partnership in our toil, so as to accomplish the heavy task of government with which earlier kings have had to struggle on their own. It is necessary that at the present time the Ethiopian people should join in all the work of government. We have therefore set up 2 chambers of parliament, so that all persons suitable, qualified for the task, should become participants in the work. The counselors who tender advice in these chambers shall come from each province, being chosen by the emperor's authority until the people are able to hold elections on the basis of education and knowledge. The advice to be decided by majority voting will come into force when it has been approved by the emperor. 4. Once advice has been tendered by parliament and been approved by the emperor, it is the responsibility of ministers to apply it to the whole of Ethiopia and to carry on the affairs of the government and the people. 5. Lest disturbances should break out and cause harm to Ethiopia, it has been determined by law that the Ethiopian imperial dignity shall not at any time secede from the dynasty in respect of which it has been written into this constitution. 6. The need for law arises so that any condition of life, as it is being improved, shall be on a well-ordered and trustworthy basis. For it is knowledge that ameliorates and moderates everything, so that the administration of Ethiopia in whatever sphere shall be led towards knowledge. It is right that we should always seek the selective acceptance of all knowledge in its various kinds. 7. This constitution which we have established is not just idle fiction or discordant with the country's customs, for it closely approaches that of the civilized and educated nations. In its preparation we had the help and ideas of our nobles and our officials, and of other Ethiopian subjects whom we had chosen for the relevant knowledge. Man makes a beginning, but it is Jah alone who has the power to accomplish things. We place our trust in Jah, that he may grant us to bring into effect this constitution which we have set up. Your Excellencies, foreign envoys and consuls, we thank you for having come to share our joy and to honor with us this fortunate day on which we have established and signed the Constitution. When we had finished this speech, our minister of the pen read out the following text of the proclamation. Having been chosen to the imperial dignity of Ethiopia by Jah's goodness and the people's united accord, acting under the law and preserving the trust which we have received from Jah when we were anointed on accepting by due process of law the crown and throne, we have brought about that our successors should take over from us by lawful means and operate within the legal framework, establishing regulations by which we will give protection to our country in honest administration under the law. We have chosen to set up a constitution explaining and expounding our ideas because we were hoping to cause pleasure and to contribute to Ethiopia's prosperity and to the strength of our government and to the profit and benefit of our beloved people. The basis upon which the Ethiopian realm is to be firmly placed in the future and which justifies the establishment of a constitution requires a trusty safeguard so that the conditions of our state shall forever be stable and firm. It being well known how this is determined by the law upon which this foundation rests and by the strength which the law is applied. For this reason, ever since we have occupied the imperial throne of Ethiopia and received this great trust from the hand of Jah, we have recognized the duty to decree and to employ means by which our realm will be strengthened and the standard of living of our people be improved and our population be led on the road to higher civilization and enjoyment by which they will obtain all the good things which the free and civilized nations have achieved. The most productive thing necessary to effect this, we have recognized it is to have the entire work of government well organized, after clarifying the need for a future constitution to ensure an enjoyable standard of living for the people and to have the state exist in peace and security by which honor will be attained that passes on from generation to another. As it is our lofty idea to bring our realm to the highest level in its long history, we have established by decree this constitution of our own free will without being requested by anyone in the second year of our reign, in 1931, when occupying the imperial throne. Subsequently, the constitution which had been prepared in writing was presented, and after we had signed it first, then beginning with our heir to the throne, the bishop and princes, ministers and notables and officials, all appended their signatures to it. The foreign diplomatic envoys signed for the sake of a memento, writing their names in a specially prepared register. Chapter 30, A Commentary on the Constitution. On the side of the officials and the people, there were few who knew what the meaning of a constitution was, but we considered it essential that they should all understand it. We directed, during the week in which the constitution was signed, that all officials and many of the people should assemble. Our Minister of Finance, Begeron Tekle Hawariat, then addressed them and explained in the following discourse. Your Majesty, the idea which has been realized in Ethiopia this year and the plan which has been initiated is of a kind which has never been carried out in any country in the world at any time whatsoever. A level towards which Ethiopia did not progress in two or three centuries has been brought about by Your Majesty in one rapid march forward, thus causing her to reach a high and lofty rank. The abundant benevolence which you have up to now shown to each one of us has been astonishing, but today's instance, while not excluding anyone, extends to the entire Ethiopian people all at once and is truly amazing, because this is being accomplished in our time, and he has granted us to see and to hear it. Our good fortune will assuredly be well remembered. It can therefore not be doubted that it will serve to glory of our time, not only for Your Majesty's sake, but even for ours. It will bring honor to future generations that come up after us. Altogether, Ethiopia has found a source of life that will secure her existence henceforth. And, while her power develops, she is able to give out light uninterruptedly shining forth like a sun forever. Therefore, all those inquiring into world affairs, both men of the present time and those to arise in the future, are full of unceasing admiration for the kindness, unexampled in the world, which Your Majesty has done to Ethiopia, quite suddenly, with no one expecting it, by Your free will and benevolence, while only Your understanding and study, Your sincere mind and obvious intelligence, which guiding you. History will judge you and above the good and wise kings. It is more than 3,000 years that Ethiopia has been known in its nationhood. From the time till today, Ethiopia has stretched out her hands towards Jah, and has been waiting patiently for some great benefit, and it is only now that Jah has caused her, at Your Majesty's hand, to be favored by the divine blessing. It is by His creating the whole world with inviolable and firm laws determined forever that the Creator causes us to believe in His existence and supreme rulership. It is through manifesting by thorough study the Creator's law and through observing it that man's greatness is particularly recognized. In this way, he brings honor upon himself and also serves his fellows. To confer suitable benefits upon Ethiopia, nothing better could be done than to set up a constitution. Nobody will fail to appreciate that it was because Your Majesty was above all convinced that no greater benefit appropriate for Ethiopia could be found that by your own will you establish a basis for the foundation of your government and determined a constitution for the governance of the people and not on account of some fanciful or other reason. While all this was planned not only for those of us who are alive now, we realized that it was done with a view to safeguarding the independence of the coming generation. Hence our gratitude is sincere. Since Your Majesty is convinced that laying a foundation for government and setting up a pillar of law is the main consideration required for safeguarding our generation, we natives of Ethiopia and all you subjects are able to appreciate and to assess the value of this and to recognize the advantages which you have brought forth us. Therefore, all your toil will not be in vain, but for this favor which you have done for us who live at the present time, can we ever know how to make an adequate return, or can a counter favor, whatever it may be, ever be sufficient? Before making the appropriate response to this question which I have posed, may I first request Your Majesty graciously to accept my sincere gratitude, which I present before your throne for having permitted me, your humble servant, the interpretation of this great concept before this august assembly. Your Highness and Princess, Your Excellencies, the Chiefs and Officials, what I request of you now is to permit me to explain to you the interpretation of the thoughts underlying the decree promulgated on 9th Hamle, 16th July, so that you may be aware of the profundity and subtlety of the idea, of who it is to be the first beneficiary of it, and what we are to do to render adequate return for His Majesty's great favor. Well then, I will myself provide answer and discussion to matters I have mentioned above, and if, after listening patiently, you find frivolity in what I say, you must chide me, but if discover matters of substance, you should store them in your heart. About the Constitution. Your Majesty has graciously caused it to be proclaimed that from now on and forever the governance of your imperial realm is to be by the determination of the law. Constitution, i.e. the law of the realm, means to set up well, to constitute. It is like setting something up by selecting from two or three things and uniting them into one only. For instance, the constitution of a wall is established by four things: stone, lime, sand, and straight leveling. And similarly, a country, people, king, and law, when united together, form the basis for the establishment of a government, and the concept of their being fused together is called a constitution. It will be found recorded in the walls of history that many great men in various epochs and in different countries toiled hard to harmonize with well-deposed application the ideas underlying the establishment of a government. Let us then indicate to you all the various kinds of expositions that have been presented as conditions and principles to be applied to the framing of constitutions in the world. 1. A king with unlimited powers, in the absence of his country of any special custom or regulations, will do as he pleases, with his caprice as the only principle guiding him from day to day, and bring about fortuitous changes according to his character. He punishes without proper judgment, and kills and hangs people. A government of this kind may be suitable for pagans, but it is not appropriate for a Christian people. The word of the Gospels does not permit it. An example of this would be, if a man lived in an accumulation of stones in a field, as in a cavern, and if they suddenly collapsed, they should crush him. This would be called arbitrary government. Succession to the throne is according to the chance of time and superior strength, and may change frequently and abruptly. Each time such a change occurs, it splits the people into factions, seeking to annihilate each other and making their fate constant bloodshed and mutual destruction. 2. A king with unlimited powers, in the absence of properly specified written legislation, proceeds by long-established customs handed down from generation to generation. He is thus able to apply punishment as well as mercy, to appoint and to dismiss as well as to hold court in open assembly, to award honors, and so issue clearly drafted proclamations. If suddenly he commits some wrong, no restraint can be placed upon him. Government of this kind has mostly remained to be practiced among peoples for whom no constitution has been set up. An example of this would be a house built with natural stone walls without mortar. This would be called a government existing by custom, which possesses a measure of tolerance. The succession to the throne is to the faction to which the chance of time may offer it. 3. A king with full authority may have specially anointed counselors who prepare legislation for him and work by meeting in special assemblies on specified occasions. The number of persons who are permitted to tender advice is denied, and they are selected from among the princes, officials, and peoples of each of the country. If the advisory assembly is held in two or three sections, then the chambers are to be organized and divided in accordance with these sections. The persons who are to be counselors within each section are chosen according to the rank of their respective parties. Parliament is divided into chambers of princes, notables, and the people. But those selected for the people's chamber, it is by the people's choice that they are appointed according to the rules, and consequently they serve as counselors for a fixed term only. Then they are removed again, and others are once more elected and substituted for them. All their deliberations are to be decided by majority vote, and are then to be submitted to the king in writing. If the king likes their counsel and accepts it, he then confirms it. He subsequently causes it to be promulgated. Afterwards, the ministers, in accordance with the instruction under the law, have to see it carried out. They have to put on trial people transgressing the law and see that they are punished. Revision or complete change of the law is undertaken after proper consultations about in according to the existing law. Government of this type is called joint rule, determined by law. Succession to the throne is no circumstances passes outside the dynasty. It rests firmly upon the words of an oath and threat of excommunication entered into by the king, the princes, the notables, and the people. An example of this is a house whose walls are built with stone, lime, and sand. 4. Then there is a republican form of government, where the head of the republic is appointed by the will of the people for a fixed period. A government like this is a communal government subject only to the authority of the people. The president of the republic demits office at the prescribed time and is succeeded by the next one, likewise elected by the will of the people. In a republican government, the president of the republic, the ministers and counselors are elected entirely by the choice of the people. Any proposal that has to be carried out is decided upon by the party with the majority of popular votes. Such a government is called government of the people. Government of this type is not for very uneducated and uncivilized people. Even in civilized countries, it often causes great difficulty and leads to bloodshed. Even if there exists another method of government apart from those enumerated, none has been discovered that is better than these for the conditions of man at the present time. There is no limit to man's desires, and as such desires increase, they have no benefit for life, but remain mere concepts. I have therefore shown you the various kinds of governance that exist in the world, and that can be of use to man's life. Well then, it is the third method of governance for which His Imperial Majesty, Haile Selassie I, has opted in the belief that it will be suitable for the conditions in which Ethiopia exists at present. I.e. the government of Ethiopia is forever to be a government of the King of Kings, Emperor, with the Emperor possessing full authority and the principal determination of the law being by the imperial will, while for the necessary matters of detail he is to be advised, for the time being, by the assembly of princes and notables. These matters are to come into force when approved by the Emperor's authority. Later on, when the people have been educated to an adequate standard of knowledge, they will be permitted to elect, on their part, men to whom the privilege of counselorship is to be given. This means that for the present, the emperor is anointing the princes, notables, and officials as tutors for the people, so that they should guide the populace towards amelioration. Thus, the constitution given to Ethiopia by His Majesty Haile Selassie I, I may be briefly defined as follows. 1. The government of Ethiopia is forever an imperial realm. The emperor possesses full authority, but his rule is subject to legal determination. 2. The Senate and Chamber of Deputies are firmly established forever and cannot be removed. The counselors are to be elected at a predetermined time from each part of the country from among the princes, notables, officials, and people. 3. The principal laws, by virtue of being based on the emperor's knowledge, shall remain permanently valid. 4. Laws concerning matters of detail are to be examined by parliament and to be decided by majority vote. After they have been ratified by the emperor's authority, they shall be promulgated. 5. Ministers are to be responsible for the work of their respective departments and have to see to it that their work is carried out in the whole of Ethiopia. 6. It is the emperor alone who is in supreme command of all the armed forces in Ethiopia. 7. It is the emperor alone who can award senior authority and rank, office and rights, decorations and honors, hereditary land rights and fiefs, rest and gold, as well as major grants of lodging and maintenance. 8. The emperor alone can proclaim war or peace. 9. After a malefactor has been convicted by due process of law, it is only the emperor who is able to lighten his sentence or to pardon him altogether. Now then, that I have explained the establishment of the basis of government in its various forms, which is termed constitution, may it be your wish to let me expound also the concept of what is called law. About the law. The meaning of law is the obligation of government to define every contract made between men so that security and peace be created for the conditions of life in the world. The meaning of law is also that it should hold responsible any man transgressing a contractual obligation and hand him over to the powers possessing the responsibility of enforcement. This being so, law provides man a distinct definition of what it permits to him so that he may fully benefit from it. Furthermore, the law, while warning man of the duties incumbent upon him, orders him to fulfill his obligations. Anything that is permitted to man to benefit by is called the right of exercise of enjoyment. the right of enjoyment is divided into two main parts. 1. Private privileges are those which are for each person in his individual capacity. 2. Joint privileges are those which are for the whole people in its entirety and for Ethiopia in her united capacity. Private and joint concepts may be of three kinds. 1. The interest of livelihood, worldly goods. 2. The interest of the mind, knowledge. 3. The interest of the inner life, love and religion. Emperor Haile Selassie I has given laws as regard the general judicial concept for all these interests, private as well as communal, which have been referred to. But for matters of detail, he has set up what is called a constitution as a basis for the establishment of government, so that the counselors should submit to him. As we have shown above, the legislative proposals they have prepared in Parliament. Up to now, I have spoken in order to expound what a constitution is and also how the determination of laws is to be done. I shall now explain in detail the answer to the question I have presented to you before. That we may know mutual aid and unity. What Emperor Haile Selassie I has done for us, other kings have done for their countries. But in other countries, improvements of this kind were not carried out by an act of spontaneous generosity, but through bloodshed and compulsions, and by leaving behind a sense of danger for all. But in our country, while the educational level of the people is as yet inadequate, our emperor, in weighing up and estimating the deficiencies and advantages for the future, has been meaning to improve the conduct of our fortunes and has arranged by his wisdom and his will that Ethiopia should rise up from the condition of mere custom in which she had been living in hitherto and pass on to a higher level of civilization. What makes this so very astonishing is the fact that all this is being accomplished in such peace and security while Ethiopia turns away from the situation in which she had been up to now and makes progress all of a sudden. The emperor being in accord with his supporters and servants, all in unity, mutual aid, and joy. This fact is by itself enough to bring honor to Ethiopia and to render her an equal with the civilized nations. In order to repay His Majesty's generosity, we must judge for ourselves and impose an obligation upon ourselves so as to be truly and sincerely submissive. When His Majesty has been graciously pleased to establish for us such an esteemed project, unless we make an equally gracious and willing return for those benefits, we shall give offense to our emperor, on the one hand, and to the most people, on the other, as well as incurring hatred all around. That is, if we are seekers on the narrow road of our own interest only and despised our common benefit, which ties us to the nation. The meaning of law is a strong and unchallengeable force which is ordained to exist among men in sanctity, purity, and honor. It is a requirement of peacefulness to be a safeguard of the interests existing among men, properly poised and forever indestructible. That which safeguards the law itself is its faithfulness in true impartiality and sincerity in the fulfillment of contracts tied to covenants. This contract attached to a covenant, referred to as law, specifically cautions on every occasion those dwelling in the world, lest they transgress the proper limits in any of their daily occupations. The law defines those limits for them, bring them into harmony, and delivers them from enmity. Therefore, the law deserves to be honored, being the supreme power above all. And we, all the natives of Ethiopia, it is our obligation and our desire to live in future with honor for the law, taking great care never to forget that we have entered into this covenant knowingly and willingly. Anyone seeking to interfere with the mode of living permitted to every man by law or seeking to cause upheaval deserves to be rebuked before the Creator and by the assembly of the people. He also deserves to be punished as an evildoer before the king. Likewise, if a man fails to carry out what the law has commanded him, or if he is found transgressing what the law has determined, then he renders himself liable to be punished by that law. It is the emperor who has entered into a contract sanctioned by covenant to safeguard with diligence that the people may benefit to the full from every aspect of life which the law permits. And it is up to us to see he succeeds in this. Again, it is the same emperor who has entered into a contract sanctioned by covenant to apply force, lest anyone should be guilty of a transgression which the law forbids. Let us then strive for his sake, to the best of our ability, to bring about success for this as well. The existence of a binding covenant between the emperor and the people entails a desire and an obligation for both parties in unison and not for one side only. Therefore, there is no greater benefit for us than the desire and obligation that is mutual to both sides. By the emperor's action of giving us the law, and by our action of accepting, honoring, and fulfilling it, we are able to make our life in this world one of hope and loyalty. As a consequence, all our thoughts will be tranquil, and this will let us take care to initiate and to bring to fruition all kinds of important and beneficial deeds. We are not wrong in considering this the main concept for our country's prosperity. If there were no law, we would have no hope amounting to any sort of confidence, but only violence and injury, and our heart would become insensitive, our life, on account of our unsuccessful plans, would become unsettled and unstable. Upon such conduct, our world would remain without proper basis, a thing of idle hopes only. When we come to assess the damage of all this, we cannot fail to be very conscious of the gravity of the matter. But by virtue of the fact that it is the emperor who gives the law, and thereby becomes the custodian of the people's benefits and deficiencies, he is given the special privilege of supreme authority and rights. It is of the essence that this should forever remain his personal prerogative, and thus no other man can challenge him. After his lifetime, it passes by due inheritance to his children, and these, in turn, according to precedence, will take over and carry on the work of government according to law, but it cannot be turned over to another dynasty. It is all the natives of Ethiopia, in their entirety, who have entered into a contract sanctioned by covenant to be guarantors of this arrangement. The principal advantage deriving from this is that it should stop the quarrels and upheavals which arise each time on the occasion of the succession to the crown and throne, and that it should prevent the mutual extermination which the division of the peoples into factions causes, as well as the dismemberment and partition of Ethiopia. If any man were to oppose or to infringe the emperor's authority, the people's interest, or the power of the law, then he would, by his own will, have become an outlaw, and no defense whatsoever could be found for him to save him from punishment. From now onwards, Ethiopia, by virtue of being protected and rendered tranquil in every respect, will, on one hand, eternally progress in every sphere of her standard of living and continually grow in wealth. On the other hand, again, as far as the outside world is concerned, she will be able to conclude treaties accruing to her benefit and honor, with her neighboring countries, regulating all mutual relations and consonant with Ethiopia's long-term interest. It is thus not very difficult for us to appreciate that these two methods of amelioration represent something of major value. When a basis for the establishment of government is set up, and the law is defined, it is not possible at the same time to discuss precisely and bring about every determination of matters of detail. This is because the people's mode of living is so very variegated in type, extent, and general distinctions, but our hope is absolute that in course of time, as the need arises, permission is bound to be granted, and this inspires our heart with confidence for the future. When that time comes, the full extent of His Majesty's generosity will be clearly seen. While it was perfectly possible for him to rule according to his wishes, like the kings in the past, and to act as his momentary caprice made by him. He abandoned all of this, and by his own will and generosity laid a firm basis for the establishment of his government and gave freedom to his people within the framework of the law. When he did this, he did not compel us to choose a particular kind of law and to live under it by simply translating the constitution of one of the civilized nations. If it had been done like this, it would have been to our detriment rather than our advantage. On the contrary, he saw to it that the constitution was in accordance with the country's customs, the people's educational level, the economic difficulties, and with the spirit of the times. He permitted the people themselves to advise on what was suitable for the time being, to be the custodians of the constitution, and to make their views known. Any proposal that had to be decided upon by majority vote required to be examined by the properly and specifically established parliament, by the assembly of the councillors, specially selected. If the proposal was suitable to become law according to the constitution, it was to be promulgated after ratification by the emperor's authority. For the present, no better method of legal procedure can be devised for us. After ratification and promulgation by the emperor, it has been arranged that the ministers who possess full powers shall be responsible for the execution of the law, and no man whatsoever, be he great or small, shall be in a position to transgress the law. Well now, I have explained to you the road along which Ethiopia is to be renewed and guided, as well as the reason for the differences compared with her early situation. Henceforth, things will be different in that Ethiopian legislation is to be devised by the knowledge of indigenous Ethiopians and to be approved by the emperor, and is no longer to be a matter that is exclusively under the guidance of foreigners. The authority of ministers will have reference to all matters directly concerning the government and the people. Chief among these are agriculture, cattle breeding, manufacture, trade, the process of justice, and all other similar matters. From now onwards, no man will be able to extinguish by power or force the rights granted to the people, or to infringe their interest, or to cause upheaval in order to bring about change capriciously, or indeed to commit acts of violence and outrageous. From now onward, the law will be a safeguard to ensure that no powerful person or upstart shall subdue the weak or the poor. It has therefore been arranged to have a printed version of the law and to make it available everywhere so that anyone may take note of the law and will thus be able to save himself from oppression under the protection of the Constitution. From now on, legal safeguards have been established so that the verdict of the judges shall be impartially dispensed, and from this the people will be able to benefit very greatly. What is permitted to the people henceforth is personal liberty and enjoyment of normal life, though not freedom of lawless conduct, nor to do anything outside the law. This recognition has been embodied in the law, so that man's intelligence be uncovered and be directed properly, that he be able to profit from his work and not be deprived of his inherited land. But if the law were merely written down and remained thus, it would be like a dead person. Hence an observer and promoter has been appointed so that it be applied properly. The product of all this will be a secure peace, improvement of civilization, and advancement in the standard of living. When I say that peaceful security will ensure, it is because it has been willed that to live by force and arbitrariness is forbidden, and that to live by law alone has become an obligation, and also because everything has been firmly based on unity so that it be protected with care. Furthermore, it is also because ministries for the successful achievement of work have been specially set up with the appropriate distribution of their respective tasks, and because they have been given the necessary authority and rightful power to bring about the fulfillment of their respective duties without mutual friction. If the superior power of the law does not succeed in making everybody responsible to it, then injustice is bound to be done to someone. As one man's injury is another's benefit, therefore it is essential that the law should be above everybody. When I say that improvement in civilization will ensue, it is because when a man is allowed to profit from his work, he is bound to compete and strive to put his inherited property right and make it prosper, to advance his standard of living by accomplishing things through the skill of his handiwork. He will save time by the knowledgeable use of new instruments and efficient methods, and will thus be able to obtain considerable profit with little effort and at little expenditure. In all things of this kind, he will engage in rivalry and competition. When I say that economic advance will ensue, it is because man will now be able to become wealthy if he proceeds along all the roads accessible to him, and everybody is bound to strive to enrich himself by hard work and to advance and to improve his standard of living. Now that I have assessed separately the advantages and disadvantages incurred by the emperor and the people, and have referred to the contractual obligations and wishes, authority and rights by which the two sides are tied to the covenant, it is proper to recall, lest we forget the duties incumbent upon us. And everybody is bound to strive to enrich himself by hard work and to advance and to improve his standard of living. Now that I have assessed separately the advantages and disadvantages incurred by the emperor and the people, and have referred to the contractual obligations and wishes, authority and rights by which the two sides are tied to the covenant, it is proper to recall, lest we forget the duties incumbent upon us. While the king and people are bound under the covenant to live by the obligations and requirements which the law commands, we are likewise mutually bound by covenant to assist them, each of us according to his entire ability, through true service and a sincere mind, as well as to join together in all things relating to Ethiopia's unity. I have, therefore, reminded you of obligations and requirements that cannot be shed by us. Furthermore, since it is necessary for the law to be equal for everyone, it is essential for all natives of Ethiopia, small and great, rich and poor, educated and uneducated, all without distinction, to profit by it according to their fate. Even though a law may be set down in fine words, unless the substance embodied in it is to be truly carried out as we have just described, or if some individual is able to transgress the law and to act willfully, then it will remain a mere sham and cannot become the real mode of life suitable for a civilized Christian government and nation. We have said that the emperor Haile Selassie I, when defining by law this basis of government which he has established, and when graciously granting it to us, has at a stroke raised Ethiopia from the position in which she had been, and has managed to place her on the high level which the civilized nations have attained. When our emperor revealed to us such a lofty thought, intending to hold us up to honor, and if we, on our part, expose him by failing to accept his plans, or by refusing negligently to extend, by our own doing, a place of dishonor. As regards this freedom, while some people fail to understand the meaning of the liberty granted to us in terms of lofty thoughts and a fine and genuine intellect, it is our duty to caution our fellow men close to us lest they be deceived into thinking that it is license that has been granted to them. Whatsoever freedom may be permitted, it is necessary for everyone to appreciate that license is not acceptable. Lest anything like this should happen, it seems to me superfluous to have to mention that the powers of enforcement of the imperial government are entirely adequate. Anything that the law has ordained, only that the same law can abolish through revision and with the emperor's permission, but no one else can cancel it. It is needful for us to have patience, for it always takes a lot of time to accomplish a great concept. That means that this entire plan, broadly conceived, cannot be successfully carried out in a day, and we must appreciate that sufficient time is required for its fulfillment. Hence, some people, lacking the patience to wait for the right time, claim that the law has been set down in writing, but has not been acted upon, lest they should annoy the people and make them lose hope. It is our duty to explain matters to our friends wherever we go. There is no one leaving school who has acquired knowledge in a day. All that has been said cannot, it seems to me, cause any displeasure to the hearts of those who love their government and their king. A wide-ranging concept of this kind is not to be initiated on slight foundations, and the essence of the scheme is to get to know, first of all, by careful research, the principal skills with which the initiative is to be successfully accomplished. If we set to work without assessing and weighing up the profit and loss which this may entail for the people, if we proceed on the strength of wanton and frivolous plans, not only shall we fail to reach a high level of civilization, but we shall in fact be bound to degenerate and retrogress towards ignorance. I do not suspect that you gentlemen who are here today will make any mistake about all this, but you cannot fail to assess the level of knowledge of perhaps a majority of the people outside this audience, and it is therefore essential that you, who are, by the Emperor's wish, leaders and tutors, should cause them to be patient and to wait until they are able to analyze the advantages and disadvantages. In order to appreciate the real meaning and value of freedom, it is necessary, first of all, to study and to develop an inquiring mind. An educated person will himself be aware and take care to restrain himself from acts of license. But an uneducated person requires as guides men who possess knowledge and uprightness, so that he may serve himself from perdition and be useful to himself as well as to others. Apart from this, it is your duty and privilege to be of service to our country and to our emperor to the best of your ability, as you are yourselves an example by which the inferior person recognizes the duty of complete obedience to his superior, and the superior appreciates the propriety with which he is to issue orders to his inferior. If in these circumstances we were all of us lending a hand, the great burden which has fallen upon the emperor alone would be eased for him by being shared and by being spread to all of us, and thus the task would be quickly accomplished to the great benefit of the people throughout Ethiopia. While we thus apply ourselves to our task jointly with our emperor, who is endeavoring to rule with truth and justice, without withdrawing the generosity which so benefits the people, thinking only of the true and lofty concept, without fear or favor, and without curbing the duty which is so pleasing to God, Jah. Let it be our foremost desire and effort that our country, Ethiopia, should attain a higher level, and that thereby our entire generation be blessed. Now, gentlemen, I have spoken thus far to the best of my ability, and if it has been to your satisfaction, then I, on my part, shall always be prepared at any future time, and it may please His Majesty to explain with my entire mind the proper application of the law. Following this, the two houses of Parliament were made ready, and the first was called Senate, the second Chamber of Deputies. 4 months later, we arranged that the councillors chosen from each district should come to Addis Ababa. The parliament was opened with great celebrations on 23rd Temkit, 1924, 2nd November 1931. The first anniversary of our coronation as emperor, since these happenings disturbed the mind of the enemy, and not content with being upset in his heart only, he declared the initial stages of the present activities of the Ethiopian government as very worrying, and it is therefore necessary that we Italians should now think about it very seriously. A man who was friendly with both sides told us the actual words he had heard being uttered.